Number of years ago, at some corporate prayer meetings where I went to college, the Lord spoke to us out of the promise in Acts chapter 2 when the Apostle Peter was quoting Joel as saying, "In these last days, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy." And the Lord spoke to us in that prayer meeting, and I think you understand what I mean when I say that. God revealed to us a little bit of what he was intending on doing in these last days. And God stirred our hearts in prayer that he wanted to raise up our sons and daughters to forcefully declare the truth. And I remember in those prayer meetings, some very special times where we knew not only was this what God wanted to do, we knew that he'd heard us as we asked. And we knew that we had the petition that we had requested of God. That was just the beginning. We began to look around and try to think, you know, where's this going to come from? How's this going to happen? And what started happening is we just began to look around and realize God's doing it in our young people right here. And we began to realize that this concept that I want to talk to you about that you see on the front of your bulletin, the generation, is not just something that God can do. It's something that God is already doing. You say, what is the generation? Well, the generation is a worldwide movement of young people who are committed to total surrender to God and total dependence on his power to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, we believe that God is doing something in our day, and as much as we might look at the current generation of young people and see maybe inconsistencies and weaknesses, I think that when God looks at the generation of young people, he sees the next generation of harvest laborers. He sees the next generation of young people that he genuinely wants to use to turn the world upside down. And he has been laying the groundwork. He is doing the work. And I would consider myself a part of the generation. And our desire is just to make young people aware of what God's doing and to have them join in with this movement that God is doing in our midst. We've got a video I'd like to show here at this time that'll give you just a little bit of a better idea of what the generation is all about.
Last 3,000 years, God's heart hasn't changed either.
God doesn't want our generation to self-destruct.
He wants them to rise above the self-centered tendencies of their culture
and live for something that is so much bigger than themselves.
In fact, God doesn't just want to do it.
He's already doing it.
Right now.
In me.
In me.
In me.
Right now, God is raising up a generation
who refuse to live for their own dreams and plans.
Who refuse to believe that life is all about me.
But will instead give everything they have.
For Jesus.
For Jesus.
For Jesus.
It's not about starting a movement.
It's about joining a movement
that God has already begun.
There is a generation
that loves the Lord Jesus with all of their hearts.
There is a generation
that surrenders without regrets
to attempt great things for God.
There is a generation
that sets their sights on God's ability
to turn the world upside down for Jesus Christ.
There is a generation
that will stand unashamed
and preach the gospel to every creature.
There is a generation
that believes that prayer can unleash the will of God
upon a waiting world.
There is a generation
that knows they can't do it,
but God can.
There is a generation
that has the potential to surpass the greatness
of any generation that has gone before.
Because God is just as great as he's ever been.
There is a generation
that believes God is willing to work.
And so are we. There is a generation of young people that is committed to total surrender to God and total dependence on his power to turn the world upside down with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's called
The Generation.
The Generation.
The Generation.
It's thrilling to me. This isn't just pious platitudes. God is doing it. Briefly, I just want to share. Last week, we were down in the Pensacola area at a local church down there. And on the final night of our rally, we had seen young people saved. I think at that point, we had seen 12 young people saved. And God was just moving in our midst there that final evening. And I gave the invitation. I preached the gospel, gave the invitation. Three more young ladies responded. And I didn't have any young men that I needed to deal with. So I decided to just extend the message a little bit and give a different kind of an invitation than I normally do. And I talked to those young people, and I said to them, I said, you know, Pastor, who had given his testimony earlier, mentioned that the most important decision he made in his life was to trust Jesus as his Savior. But he said the second most important decision was when he chose God over the game of basketball. Essentially, when he surrendered his life and surrendered everything to Jesus. And I started talking to those young people, and I said, you know what, young men? We had a bunch of young men from the ROTC, the public high school nearby. I said, men, there are some young men in the public high school that need to hear about Jesus, don't they? They said, yes, sir. I said, who's going to tell them? Several of those young people piped up, and in unison, they said, we are, sir. I began to ask. I said, you know what, some of you may not be in the ROTC, but you're in your public school, and you've got classmates that need to hear about Jesus. You know what total surrender means? You're going to talk to them. Who's going to talk to them about Jesus? Others said, we are, sir. And I said, you know what surrender means? Surrender means that there are some things Jesus might point out in your life that he doesn't like and he wants you to get rid of. And guess what? Surrender is going to get rid of it. Surrender means that if God reroutes what you're planning on doing with your life, you're going to go the way God wants you to go. Surrender means that if there are people you're hanging out with he doesn't want you hanging out with, you'll stop it. Surrender affects every decision of every day. And I asked the young people, I said, young people, we had about, 45 to 50 young people there that night. I said, young people, I want to ask you a question. And in fact, in a moment, I'm going to ask you, if you mean business about this, no heads are going to be bowed. No eyes are going to be closed. I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet if you're willing to totally surrender your life to Jesus like that. And I explained and made sure they understood what I was talking about. And I said, all right, young people, who here is willing to say, I am surrendering to Jesus completely and totally, stand to your feet. 30 to 40 young people stood up. And you've got to understand, many of these young people, a week prior, had been lost. And what was thrilling to me was to see how God was moving. These weren't just Christian teens that were already surrendered. We got young people. In fact, a young man, after everything was done, he looked at me and he said, Preacher, he said, if God tells me to go to Guatemala, I think I'll do it. I think, well, he might already be doing something. I don't know. But you know, it was a thrill to me to see these young people and their heart. I think young people are thirsting to make a difference nowadays. I think even lost young people, they want their lives to count. And we have a cause to live for. We have a Savior to live for. And God has given us everything we need, not only to live righteously and godly in this present age, but he's given everything that we need to genuinely reach this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you know, it's our heartbeat of our team. In fact, fellas, if you make your way up here, it is our heartbeat of our team that we not just talk about Jesus, that we stand up for him, not in our own strength, but in the strength of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall be lead. Till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you, ye not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Where duty calls or danger, be never wanting there. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey. Forth to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Ye that are men, now serve him against unnumbered foes. Let courage rise with danger and strength to strength oppose.
Stand
up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner. It must not suffer loss. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him that overcometh, the crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign eternally. Stand up for Jesus, stand for Christ alone.
Oh, what a blessing. You know, it's still in my mind, and we were at the couples getaway, and it still got brought up again, the impact of Miss Stringer just a week ago. And just the thought of her saying, it doesn't make sense that preachers come in and try to plead with young people to surrender to God. When she prayed for days, I guess it was, she said, as a teenager, she prayed and begged God, use me. And, you know, I said, that's not unusual. Paul said, that's reasonable. That's normal Christianity, yeah, to say, God, use me. Yeah. And something is strangely abnormal about us having to plead with people to serve the greatest, the most faithful, the most loving. It doesn't make sense. But somehow we've been duped into believing we can have God and still have it our way. He's not Burger King, by the way.
Amen.
So that at this time, I like for our teenagers to come and I just to give a microcosm of what it is I believe that God is trying to do within our lives, and let them, with by way of song, just testify what they're signing their name to as far as reasonable service. Amen. And I appreciate so much what God is doing, and I just I think God has much more in store for every one of these young people, every one of them. And so listen as the young people sing.
Trust it in all things. It's
I think that's something that we can all stand upon, that which is timeless and true, the Word of God. Thank you, young people. It's a blessing being able to see them, get up and take that stand and sing. Brother Bosler's going to come. He's going to preach to us. Now let me ask you, teenagers, make sure you stay awake. It's not time. We're not doing a sleep study, so make sure you're awake. Nathan, it's your job to keep them awake there. Keep them awake. Take the hymnal to them if you need to. All right? Guys, you need to do that. It's very important. We'll make sure you're engaged. You can't hear if you're not awake. And, all right? Adults, stay awake. And show them. Invitation comes. You ought to lead the way. Remember Joshua, as for me and my house, they will serve the Lord. Is that what he said? We need to lead. We need to demonstrate. And so let's make sure we're engaged in what God, there's nothing more important than these next few moments, because that which is timeless and true is being opened and declared, and this is God's method to transform and change lives. Brother Bosler, it's a privilege to have you. Please come and preach to us.
You know, it says in Acts 2 that your old men are the one who dream dreams, so the young men better stay awake here this morning. I think we're engaged. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 3. Thank you. I was so excited to jump down on fire. Mike, God has something, I think, in store for us here this morning. I spent some time in Sunday school with the young people just sharing a little bit of my testimony, and I told them, I said, you know, it's easy to look at someone who's a preacher, who's out in ministry, and to think that maybe everything went right for them, and that I think we've got it. It's not on. All right, I must have turned it off. I'll let you figure this out
somehow.
Up and going now. Very good. I shared with the young people this morning just my testimony, and as I said, it's easy to look at somebody who's been in ministry and think they've always been on top of things and they've always been where they ought to be, but that's just not the case. And you know, my life is a testimony of a life that should not have turned out for the Lord. I shared with them briefly, I was born illegitimately. And because of that illegitimacy, it would have been easy for folks to just write me off. But God was taking care of me all through the way. God brought me into a home. My parents adopted me when I was just after I was born. And they raised me for the Lord. They raised me in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And they raised me in a good church that taught me how to stand up for the truth. I'm so thankful for that. I'm thankful that God at key points, your pastor being one of them, brought men of God across my path that went after me sometimes, that went after the things that were in my life that shouldn't have been there. And I'm glad that not only did men of God go after me, but the Spirit of God went after me as well. And as a senior in high school, I surrendered my life to Jesus to do whatever he called me to do. In Bible college, God clarified that to be evangelism. Later on in my Bible college years, God further clarified that he wanted me to reach the next generation of harvest laborers with the gospel of Jesus Christ. God stirred me. I remember having conversations with your pastor at Starbucks up there in Menominee Falls, Wisconsin, and just talking to him about my burden. I wanted to see young people saved, but I wanted to see God do more than that. The Lord used some of those conversations just to further hone the methodology of what we're trying to do, not only in training folks in how to counsel in the counseling room, in the war, but also to give them a vision for what needs to happen after that. And even in addition to those things, God just honed our burden that we needed to set our sails for when the wind of God was blowing. You know, I think a lot of times, you know, we think, oh, that'd be nice if that kind of thing happens one day, but God doesn't expect us to sit around and wait for stuff to start happening. He expects for us with expectation to step out of the boat and to see God do a miracle. Amen. And what we found is, as I mentioned, as we began to present the burden of the generation, which, by the way, there are a couple things on the table out there. No doubt you saw the bright orange table when you came in. But we've got a little square card. Feel free to grab one of these if you'd like. This is just a description of what the generation is all about. And I've mentioned this before. I'll mention it again. It's a generation of young people committed to total surrender and total dependence. That's the key. Total surrender. Total dependence. God wants us, as Pastor mentioned, which is our reasonable service, he wants us to surrender to the will of God. And as God makes his will clear to us, we're going to realize that that will is not hard. It's impossible. You know, as a young person, when God was calling me to preach, I shared with the teenagers. I remember specifically in the back of my auditorium in a little church in Pensauken, New Jersey, God spoke to my heart and said, "Hey, Bobby, I want you to be a preacher." And I said, "Okay." And I freaked out about it later because I thought, I don't speak in front of people. I don't know how to do this kind of thing. I can't do it. And my mom gave me the best piece of advice I've ever gotten. What God calls you to do, he'll enable you to do. And as God continued to hone what he was calling me to do from just being a preacher to being an evangelist, and then as God stirred my heart that he wanted to in some small way use me to contribute towards a worldwide missions movement among our youth, I remember thinking, there's no way. There's no way. That's exactly where God wants us to be. God wants to set us face to face with a there's no way. So that we know when it happens, it wasn't us, it was God. Amen. And so what I want to do here today, my goal is this morning, I really want to focus on the total surrender side of things. And the evening service, I really want to focus on the total dependence side of things, just to give you a little bit of a structure for where we're going today. But let me just say this to start off our message here this morning. I just want to start off with a statement that will apply just as much to the young people down here as it will to anyone else here in this room. God has a plan for your life. God has a plan for your life. And I think many times as we head into our lives, we really, really think that our lives, not so much by what we say in church or by what we say amen about in church, but I think based on the decisions that we make day in and day out in our lives, we really don't believe that God has a plan for our lives. Oh, we want the blessings of God. We want God to give us money so we can buy a nice house. We want God to give us money so that we can buy a nice truck or a boat. But we don't necessarily always want God's will. We want him to take care of us. But we aren't many times willing to do what he wants us to do. And what I want to do here is I want to take a look at the book of Philippians. And I want to take a look at a few verses that I have found are a testimony, not for me here, though some of that I'm sure will be smattered throughout the message, but a testimony from the Apostle Paul himself. In fact, if you look at verse 3 of chapter 3, he says, "For we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more." And I'm not going to elaborate on all of this, but I just want to say, Paul himself, though he had a lot of things going for him, he had to come to the point in his life where he realized his heritage, where he realized his religious upbringing could not contribute to his eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Paul had to come to the point where he realized, "I can do nothing to get myself to heaven." He had to come to that point. In fact, that's what I think he's talking about personally here in this passage. He says, "Circumcised in the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law a Pharisee, concerning zeal persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law blameless." And look at what he says in verse 7, "But what things were gained to me? The things that I thought were to my advantage. Those things," the list of things I just mentioned, "those things I counted loss for Christ." The things I used to think would get me to heaven, I stopped. I recognize those things are going to send me to hell if I trust in them. And you know what? I think all of us have to come to that point. In fact, he goes on in the next verse. He says, "Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him,
not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. Paul's testimony here is, I had to come to the point where I recognized all the things that I thought would get me in good with God, all of the things that I thought would seal my eternal destiny in heaven. I had to count all of those things but loss. I had to stop counting on all of those things so that I could come to Jesus and Jesus alone to find my forgiveness of sins and eternal life. And you know what? Maybe there's somebody here this morning, this is not the main point of my message, but maybe there's somebody here this morning, you really think you got it going when it comes to God. Maybe you've got a relative who's a preacher. Maybe you've gone to church for your entire life. Maybe you've prayed a prayer, or you've walked an aisle, you fill out a card, and you think, hey, I've done the church thing. Look at me. I've got this under control. I'm going to heaven because I am so righteous. Can I tell you, friend, there's none righteous, no, not one. The Bible tells us very clearly, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. And only through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And if you're here today, and if in your heart you think, man, if I go to church, pray, read my Bible, do good things, I'll go to heaven. Friends, I want you to know you're on your way to a sinner's hell, and you'll burn there forever. Jesus came to die on the cross. He took our place on the cross of Calvary. He bore the wrath of God instead of us so that we can come to him and be made, as the scripture says, the righteousness of God in him. But you've got to come to the end of your own works, of your own self-righteousness, and come to Jesus and depend on him alone. But I want you to know something, friends. Jesus, for those of you that have already counted all things but loss for Christ, Jesus saved you for a purpose. I want you to look at the next verse here. In verse number 10, it says, that I may know him. Did you know one of the reasons why Jesus saved you is so you could know him? So you could have an intimate, personal relationship with Jesus. Young people, the reason why Jesus saved you however many years ago was so that you could spend time with him. So you could no longer be God's enemy, but instead you could be his friend, the one to whom he wants to manifest his love and his presence to. Not so, young people here in this room, Jesus saved you so you can have a real, vibrant, intimate relationship with him. But that's not all he saved you for. It says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Jesus also wants you to understand and experience the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. You know, one day you're going to experience the incredible resurrection power. That day when either Jesus comes back and you're alive and you get caught up to be with him in the air, or that day when you're dead in a coffin and the first resurrection takes place and boom, you bust out of that coffin up to glory. I'm telling you, friends, that's power. But the resurrection power is not just a future reality. It's one that God wants you to experience every day of your life. I don't know if you've noticed this, but when God calls you to do something, sometimes it feels like you're going to die. You know what I'm talking about? God's telling me to talk to that person. Oh, I couldn't do that. God's calling me to talk to my parents about the garbage going on behind their back. I would die, and if I didn't, they'd kill me, we could tend to think. You know what I'm talking about. I've been there. You know, when God calls us to confess to our boss that we've been cheating on our hours, when God calls us to go and quit that job because it's an ungodly job and you shouldn't be in it as a Christian, when God calls you to go make restitution for something you've done, it feels many times like you're going to die. Even beyond just the negative stuff, when God calls you to go do something for him, when God calls you to step out in faith and do something you'd never done before, something that seems scary, many times it seems like I'm going to die. And guess what? God wants you to experience the resurrection power. I think he wants you to die so that he can raise you from the dead every day of your life. But he wants us to know him. He wants us to have a personal relationship with him. He wants us every day to experience the power of his resurrection and something we don't like to think of, the fellowship of his sufferings. Did you know God wants things to go bad in your life? That's not a health and wealth gospel, is it, Pastor? God wants things to go bad in your life because he wants to perfect you. And you know, there's some things you just can't learn unless you go through them. Yesterday on our way here, we stopped at a rest area, just had to do a couple things with the trailer. And my son went into our bathroom in the trailer and he comes out yelling, "Dad, the door to the shower fell off."
And the whole door assembly just fell off. And last night, I learned a whole lot about how my shower assembly works. Thankfully, I got a couple S-hooks and some zip ties, and it's almost good as new, except my wife won't let me leave it like that for a while. By the way, if anybody knows how to weld, talk to me after the service. But anyway, you know, it's funny because you can't learn how to fix problems and get through challenges unless you go through them. And what Jesus wants us to do is he wants us to go through those valleys so it will deepen our fellowship with him. One of the reasons why Jesus purchased you, one of the reasons why he saved you, is not only so you could know him and have fellowship with him, not only so you could experience his power, but so you could experience his presence in the valley of the shadow of death. He says being made conformable unto his death, and I think that's just saying, you know what? It feels like we're going to die every day. He says, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect. And here's really what I want to focus on here this morning. He says, the Apostle Paul, but I follow after. If that I may apprehend, that for which I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. You know what the Apostle Paul's saying right here? You know what he's saying? He's saying, you know what I want more than anything in my life? You know what I want more than my cup of caffeinated coffee in the morning? You know what I want more than a raise? You know what I want more than, honestly, just the general concept of people being saved and folks getting revived? You know what I want more than anything? I want to get my hands on. I want to get my hands around. I want to get into my possession. I want to make my own the purpose that Jesus purchased me for. He says, in essence, I want to get what I was gotten for. I mentioned earlier, Jesus bought you for a reason. God has a purpose for your life. The purposes we saw in the verse prior are universal purposes that God has for every believer. God wants you to know him. He wants you to experience his power. He wants you to fellowship with him in the midst of sufferings. He wants you to experience the resurrection from the dead every day. But you know what? Beyond that, God has specific purposes for your life. You know, I like to think of it like this. I like the word calling. The way I like to define the word calling is it is your customized life purpose. It is your reason for existence. You ever ask yourself the question, why am I here on this earth? Why am I here today? Not just why am I in church, but why am I here? Why am I alive? Why am I breathing? Why did God let me be born? And honestly, that's a pretty special question for me. And again, I'm sorry for a little bit of overlap, young people, but I was born illegitimately as a child. And again, I'm not going to go into all the details, but my birth mother had me in a way that shouldn't have been had. And I was adopted by my parents. They raised me for the Lord. And as they raised me for the Lord, I didn't find this out until much later in my life. As a child, my adopted mom and dad dedicated me not only to the ministry, not only to be a preacher, but they dedicated me to be an evangelist. They didn't tell me that till I was partway through Bible college, already committed to the calling of God. But you know what's amazing to me? My parents didn't come up with that. Did you know that? My parents didn't come up with that. Because according to my Bible in Jeremiah chapter 1, God said to Jeremiah, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I ordained thee to be a prophet unto the nations. And you know what, friends? Can I tell you, young people down here, every single one of you, before you were ever born, God had a calling for you. God had something he wanted you to accomplish on planet Earth. And you know, not just you young people here, every not-so-young person here this morning, God has a purpose for you to be on this planet. God has a purpose for you, and I'm not just talking about the general things. I'm talking about God has a customized life purpose for you. I remember in college, I was really enamored with a fellow who was a missionary evangelist in Southeast Asia. I greatly respected him. I was thrilled for what God was doing in his life. And I really assumed that since I really liked this guy and I loved what he did, I thought, you know what? I think that's what I'm going to do too. I'm going to be a missionary evangelist to Southeast Asia. I remember talking to a mission board saying, hey, would you guys ever have something with a missionary evangelist? And I heard, no. but anyway, that's what I thought I was going to do. I traveled a summer in ensemble. I told all the pastors that I was with, I'm going to be a missionary evangelist. Only problem with that was that's not what God wanted me to do. I thought it'd be a nice idea, but that wasn't God's calling on my life. I remember I traveled with Dr. Jim, one of his team members. I loved it, but honestly, I didn't think a whole lot about it other than that'd be a neat thing to do again one day. But it was, I believe, my first senior year. I took two of them. My first senior year of Bible college at Baptist College of Ministry. I remember we did some a little war at a public park nearby. And I remember at that public park, I loved it. I'm telling you, I was in my element. I don't even think I was a team captain. I was just the guy who knew all the setup and everything, running around, making things happen. And I just loved it. There was a young man I'd led to Christ. He gave a salvation testimony one of the nights. And I was just loving it. And I remember my director of my Sunday school, Oriel O'Gorman, he pulled me aside after the following evening service. And he said to me, hey, Bob, he's from Ireland. He said, hey, Bob, did you ever think that maybe you could do what Dr. Jim does one day? And I remember it had never even crossed my mind. And I remember I said to him, well, man, I would love to do that, but God would have to open that door. Well, little did I know God was working. I remember shortly after that, I couldn't get it out of my mind. In fact, we had a dorm devotions. I think it was either that night or the following night. And the dorm leader, I remember he said something that was highly insulting to me. I had one young man who traveled with that same evangelist on his internship and been out there. Another young man in my room that was from Southeast Asia. And I remember the leader, he said something that intimated that these two guys were going to go to the mission field, but I wasn't. And I was thinking, what are you talking about? I've told everybody, this is what I'm called to do. And honestly, even though he may or may not have realized what he'd said, God was talking to me. And I remember later on that night going out on the deck, just out behind the apartment that we were living in. And I remember getting on my knees on a chair. And I remember saying to God, God, are you rerouting me here? God, I've told everybody what I think you've called me to do. God, are you calling me to reach young people with the gospel? And I remember in my heart, as clearly as anything, I remember it was as if God said yes. Now, here's the thing, though. There was this girl who was traveling with Dr. Jim, and I had overheard her say that she loved traveling. I'd overheard that she'd said that she loved reaching teens, and I was really suspect of my own heart, just to be honest with you. And I remember there saying, God, okay, this could be totally me manipulating the situation. Because I'll be honest with you, that's possible to do. Did you know that? It's possible to manipulate your parents into getting you where you want to go to college. It's possible to manipulate the circumstances and even to convince yourself in your own mind that this is what you're supposed to do when it's really not. And I was just so suspect of my own heart. I knew my heart was deceitful and desperately wicked, and I didn't want to change course for a girl as much as she is amazing, and I married her eventually, giving things away a little bit too much. But I said to the Lord, I said, okay, God, if this is something that you want me to do, if this is something that you are calling me to do, bring a brand new young man into my Sunday school class tomorrow and let me lead him to Christ. Well, the next morning, I'll never forget, I'm sitting at my Sunday school table. We had small groups too. And I remember a brand new young man came in off the bus. And I remember sitting there, you know, the table time beforehand. And I remember thinking, if I take him over there, he's going to get saved. And I thought, well, let's do it. So I took him over there. He got saved. And I thought, wow, God's confirming this. This is amazing. But wait a minute, that could have been a coincidence. You've been there too, admit it, okay? That could have been a coincidence. God, I need more. I was walking around the church building, and I was just talking to the Lord, wrestling over this, grappling with this. And I remember it was as if God, a little bit in a huff, I don't know if God gets in a little bit of a huff, but it seemed that way to me, said, all right then, ask for two tonight. Okay, give me two tonight. Well, honestly, I remember having the verse in my mind, if we ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, we know that we have the petition we've requested. And I remember thinking, if God told me to pray that, he probably means to do it. And so I remember I told my friends, I said, hey, I don't know where I'm going to go tonight, but I think I'm going to lead two people to Christ. I called up my dad and I said, hey, Dad, guess what? Two people are going to get saved tonight. He said, Bobby, are you okay? I said, I'm doing better than I have ever been. And that night, sure enough, I remember I went out. There were two young ladies in a minivan. I got to talk to them and share the gospel, and both of them got saved. And I remember I came home that night with the holy convincement in my heart that I was beginning to figure out my purpose. I was beginning to figure out specifically why God saved me, why he created me, what he had called me to do even from my mother's womb. Well, I remember I was in the middle of a class on marriage and the family. And during that class, I remember our pastor was teaching that for young men, it's very important for them to be close to their fathers when it comes to determining life direction and profession and so on. And I remember I called up my dad that afternoon and I told him what God was doing in my heart. My dad was well aware of what I said I was called to do. And I told him everything that God had done. I told him about the answers to prayer and how God was working in my heart. And I'll never forget, my dad said to me, he said, Bobby, I've never seen you on the mission field, no offense, but your mom and I have always seen you working with teens. And I remember sitting there in that conference room weeping because I knew God had confirmed it. Amen. And you know what? God has a purpose for your life too, a specific purpose. Young people, God has a set of tasks he wants you to accomplish with your life. And you know what? I don't think it's to go out and make a lot of money. I don't think it's to go out and have a high-profile profession. I'm not trying to be anything. I'm just saying the Bible says the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. And you know what? Jesus gave us a prayer request in those verses. Did you know that? You know, just like he gave me a prayer request that day, his prayer request is, pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. You know, I'm not against doctors or nurses, but we don't need more doctors and nurses. We need people who will serve the Lord Jesus Christ with their lives. We don't need more millionaires. We need more people who are rich in the things that are true riches. We need folks who are willing to not only figure out what God is calling them to, but are willing to surrender to that. You know, my surrender as a high schooler was a surrender to the general call to preach. But you know what? Along the way, as God continued to reveal his will to me, there were surrenders every time. It was a blow to my pride to admit that I had been wrong in what I thought I was going to do. It was a dose of humility. It was humble pie, and it didn't taste very good. But you know what? God is calling us to surrender. He's calling us to surrender. And you know, Paul's burden and his vision and his passion was not only to figure out what God wanted. I think he had that well figured out shortly after the road to Damascus. He knew God was calling him to be the pioneer missionary, to blaze the trail, to reach the Gentiles with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Specifically, that was his mission field. I'm not just talking about generally to preach the gospel. His specific mission field was the northeastern Mediterranean. And here in this verse, he's saying, if that I may apprehend, get a hold of that for which I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. He says, I want to get what I was gotten for. Jesus bought me for a purpose, and I will fulfill that purpose. If it's the last thing I do. What's interesting to me is right before that phrase, if that I may apprehend, he says, but I follow after. That's actually one word in the original languages, and I won't bore you with the details there, but what's so interesting about this word is that it's exactly the same word that the Bible uses to describe Paul's persecution of the church. You know what Paul did before he was saved? I talked to the young people about this in Sunday school. You know what Saul did before he was saved, right? Breathing out threatenings and slaughters against the disciples of the Lord. He went to the high priest. He got letters authorizing him to chuck Christians in jail. And you know what you could say Paul did with every breath,
With every step, with every moment, an iota of energy in his life, he gave everything he had to wiping Christianity off of the map. He relentlessly pursued Christians so he could wipe them out. And now Paul's saying, you know what? I have a new pursuit. I have something else now that I'm relentlessly pursuing. You know what it is? God's will for my life. God's specific life calling for me. You know, I think some of you here, you're just thinking about the teenagers right now. I want you to think about yourself. Some of you here have wasted years of your life because you didn't obey God when he spoke to you.
Amen.
Some of you here in this room, I'm not just talking about before you were saved. I'm talking about after you were saved. You knew God has something specific he wanted you to do with your life, but you came up with excuses like, my kids are in college, I can't afford to do that. You came up with excuses like, you know what, I'd never been to Bible college. I just don't think I could do that kind of a thing. You come up with excuses on why you couldn't do it. Maybe it was just that you felt uncomfortable. Maybe it was just that you didn't want to do it. Maybe it was that you had better things to do. But some of you here, I'm talking to the adults right now. I'm actually not talking to the teens because they're not young enough to have done that. Maybe they have. I don't know. Some of you have wasted decades. But you know what? God is never done with us.
Amen.
Listen, you may have run from the call of God. You may have gotten off course. And you may have ended up in a life's work that God never intended for you. And oh, God is gracious and God is good. God forgives and he'll even take care of you. He'll even answer your prayers during those times. But the fact of the matter is, you know deep down inside that as a youngster, younger in your life, you surrendered to something. But you never followed through. Oh, you may have followed after it for a little while, but you know, when things got hard, you gave up. You may have followed God's will for a few years. Maybe even you did go off to Bible college, but you never did anything with the calling of God. And I want you to know the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. And you know what? When God calls you to do something, he intends for you to do it. I know that's real basic. But you know, I think you just might find yourself stuck until you get alone with God and admit with him where you took your life back and give it back to him. I just think you might need to get back to that surrender. In fact, just last Sunday, I was preaching actually out of this text. I've been burdened about this text lately. And I had a man come up to me after the service. You know, the hoary head and all of that, white hair, probably 40, 50 years, my senior. And he came up to me and he said, Brother Bosler, he said, God has used your message this morning to confirm to me that I'm supposed to go out into evangelism. He said, you know what? I spent my life running. And he said, but you know what? I'm here now. I'm retired. I've got a pension. I don't even need support right now. And he said, you know what? I think I'm going to do it. Honestly, that was touching to me. And you know what, some of you young people here, you've got your own plans. And I want you to know Jesus didn't purchase you for you to do your own plans. He purchased you so you could do his plans. And you know what, parents, we should not discourage our kids from doing what God has called them to do. I think sometimes parents have an eye on their own comfort and well-being when their kids are older. And I think they think more about them, their kids doing and surpassing them and their own excellence than they think about their kids doing God's will. And I want you to know, never discourage your kids from serving God. Never say, oh, that's a nice idea, but you need something to fall back on, so let's go over and do this so you can get a nice profession, so you can make a bunch of money. I'm telling you, you're selling your kids out.
Amen.
Friends, I want you to know that God is the Lord of all the universe, and you don't need to worry about them, your kids, getting taken care of if they're on the payroll of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You don't need to worry about your grandchildren if they go off to some mission field because God has them in the hollow of their hands. God said to the Apostle Paul when he was there at Corinth, he said, don't fear, but instead I want you to speak. He says, because I am with you, because no man shall set on thee to harm thee, for I have much people in this city. He says, listen, nobody's going to lay on a finger on you that I don't let lay a finger on you. And yet I think sometimes we think of Charles Wesco, right? We think of Jim Elliot, and we think of some of these men who died
on the mission field and we think, I don't want that to happen to my kids. You know, that may be your earthly perspective. But if you saw things on the other side, if you saw the triumphant entrance that those men had when they came into glory, if you saw the eternal ripple effects that came from surrender even unto death, if you really had the heavenly perspective, I think you might think differently about it. You know, we need to let go of our children, and we need to let God work in their lives, and we need to let God lead them and guide them. And we need to be willing for them to follow the call of God into places you might feel unwise. Did you know the children of Israel, some of them thought it was unwise to go into the promised land? Did you know that? They thought it's unwise, it's not safe in there. This is not my normal message, this must be for you. He said, you know, the children of Israel, you know, they ended up at Kadesh Barnea there, right? They sent the spies in to check it out. They came back and said, there's no way. Oh, it's good, but there's no way. They've got giants in that place. The walls go all the way up to heaven. There's no way we can do this. Think of the children. Just think of the grandchildren. And you know what God called that? Rebellion. He called it rebellion. What's interesting to me is God held the parents responsible. Anyone under 20, they were not held responsible. They were allowed eventually to enter the promised land. But anyone over 20, they had died as carcasses in the wilderness. And you know, you need to take very seriously diminishing what God is saying to your kids when they're around that 20-year-old mark. You need to take it very seriously, because you might sway your kids away from ministry, but you might make them a carcass in the wilderness one day. I don't know where that came from. But you know, I'm burdened about this here today, because in this verse, he's saying, listen, I didn't just start well. I was always abounding, steadfast, unmovable, knowing that my labor will not be in vain in the Lord. He was saying, you know what? God has shown me what he wants me to do, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm not going to give up until the job is done. I'm not going to back down until my mission field has been reached. I'm not going to back up, give up, until I've fully fulfilled God's calling for my life. I follow after. Look at verse 13. He says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. What he's saying there is essentially, you know what I've got my eyes on? The purpose of God for my life. I'm not going to let my past distract me from reaching forth to what God has for me today. I don't believe this is just talking about spiritual growth, though I think that's a part of it. I think this is talking about accomplishing the will of God. Maybe you're here and you have wasted decades of your life. Forget about it and serve God today. Maybe you're here, maybe God's used you in great ways in the past, and you think, you know what, hey, it's retirement age. It's time for me to have my break today, as Pastor mentioned. But you know what? He's saying, listen, don't let the past affect your fervency in the present. You know, some of the most dangerous times for me personally as a preacher are right after God's really used me. Because those are the times when I feel like, you know what? I think I got this thing down. And you know what happens every time? I told the young people this in Sunday school. We fall flat on our face. You know, don't ever be distracted by defeat or placated by success. It's so easy to think, you know, I've filled my quota, I've served the Lord with my life, I'm done. I'm just going to move down to Florida and retire. Listen, you never retire from fulfilling God's purpose till the day you die. Really, what I'm calling us to here this morning is that God has a will for your life, a specific one, and our job is to surrender without regrets, to do God's will. Young people, I want you to know God's will is bigger than just an occupation. God has a will for every moment of you every day. God has a will for how you use your phone, young people. God has a will for how you interact on social media. God has a will for how you talk to your parents. He has a will for you and what you say and what you do at school. He has a will for how you interact with your brothers and sisters. He has a will for you in every way, shape, or form. He has a will for you how fast you drive, too, by the way. God has a specific will for you. And surrender says, you know what? More than anything in my life, I want God's will. More than I want to know who wins tonight, I want God's will. More than I want to get a high-paying profession one day, I want God's will. More than I want to go to college where my friends are going to college, I want God's will. Young people, I want you to know that God's will is an amazing place to be. Amen. There's true fulfillment in knowing you're doing what God created you to do. And I'm going to talk tonight about the dependent side of things. But you know what? What God calls you to do is going to seem pretty scary. But when you leave God out of the equation, it's going to seem impossible, and you're going to run away, and you're not going to do it, and you're going to rebel like the Israelites did. But if you recognize the God that called you is the God who can also enable you, you can surrender with confidence that it's not up to me to do it. It's up to God to do it through my life. You know, when it comes to this matter of total surrender and total dependence, this really is the Christian life. You know, we got bright orange stuff, and we're gearing it towards teenagers because they are the future. But you know what? Every one of us here in this room really needs to join the generation. Every one of us here in this room really does need to commit to total surrender to the will of God and total dependence on His power to turn the world upside down with the gospel of Jesus Christ. God delights in using, as I mentioned to the young people, messes that He cleans up and gives them a purpose and uses them to turn the world upside down. If you'll come to God and humble yourself before Him and say, God, not my will, but thine be done. Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? If you'll come with the heart of Paul that says, I follow after, I relentlessly pursue, if that I may apprehend that for which I am apprehended. Listen, I just think that might be a sacrifice that's acceptable unto God. And I just happen to think that God just might use you to do great things for Him. Why don't we do this? Can I have every head bowed? And as you bow your head, if you could stand here at this time. I want to have an invitation here this morning. And I recognize the fact that God could be working in a multitude of different ways. Maybe God's working in hearts about specific sins that you know you need to get right, and the step of surrender is to get right. Maybe there's some here God has a specific specific calling for you that He wants you to do. You've been resisting Him. Maybe here this morning there are small things you need to surrender to Him, or big things that you need to surrender to Him about here this morning. But here's what I want to do. If you here today, I'm going to make this very clear. If you here this morning would say to me, whether you've surrendered before or this is the very first time, if you here in Canaan Baptist Church this Sunday, February 3rd, are willing to say, preacher, the best I know, I am willing to totally surrender my life to God, whatever that means. If you're willing to say that, here's what I want you to do. In a moment when the piano plays, I want you to come forward. I want you to take a knee or sit on the front row, whatever you're able to do. And I just want you to tell God by your coming forward, I'm willing to totally surrender my life to the Lord. Does that sound fair? Does that sound fair here this morning? Here's what we're going to do. If you mean business, I'm talking to the young people and I'm talking to the adults. If you're here today and you say, preacher, I am willing to totally surrender my life to the Lord, as the piano plays, you come.